This time on The Adventures of Tarka. I make my longest passage to date with an overnight sail to Montserrat, explore the remains of a town destroyed by a recent volcanic eruption, and enjoy a leisurely sail aboard King of Bongo. The trip from St. Martin to St. Bart's may have marked my first ocean passage, but the one that followed was a true test to see if I had what it takes to single-hand my little boat to much farther off destinations. I am sailing in tropical latitudes, outside the cyclone season, so it's not likely that I'll face mountainous seas or hurricane-force winds. However, the 80-mile sail from St. Bart's to Montserrat is a test of my basic seamanship, my ability to keep a semblance of a watch while remaining rested, and also a chance to become a more confident sailor. I departed St. Bart's in the evening and set a course in the general direction of Montserrat. I let the wind vane do the steering, and in my opinion, a wind vane is a mark of a passage-making boat. Hand steering just really isn't an option for a solo sailor, and electronic autopilots require power that is already in high demand. Wind vanes are relatively simple devices. If Tarka goes even slightly off course, then the wind angle changes, and this vane deflects. That motion is translated into a rotation of a trim tab below the water, which causes the paddle to swing left or right under the tremendous force of water flowing by. That swing in motion is then translated to the tiller by a series of ropes, and the boat is turned in the opposite direction. Wind vanes can only react to course changes, but the same is true even with the best helmsman. The sun slowly set as I prepared for my first overnight passage. The plan was to wake up every 20 minutes, do a quick check of my surroundings, and then go back to sleep. Tarka's wind vane steered me successfully the entire way to Montserrat without much need for correction.
At one point though, during one of my short naps of course, the boat unexpectedly tacked and I awoke quickly as a result of the sudden change in motion and got us back on track. But hey, no self-steering system is perfect.
Other than that, the night was uneventful. The moonless sky was full of brilliantly lit stars and the boat stirred up a wake of bioluminescent plankton. It was peaceful. A faint glow on the horizon indicated the coming dawn, and the sunrise that followed was one I'll never forget. Unspoiled, with nothing but the creaking of the boat and the sloshing of the sea around. Just beyond, the dramatic mountains of Montserrat came into view for the very first time. Though I knew I was on the right track, it was a relief to see land again. I admit, 18 hours is nothing by ocean crossing standards, and my longest voyage yet will be over 30 days at sea. However, for someone who just started sailing a few months prior, I felt proud, like I could do anything with this little boat of mine. I anchored in a little bay on the north side of the island, which is really the only option. My friends on King of Bongo arrived a bit later, and the next day we decided to take their boat for a short sail into the volcanic exclusion zone to the south.
I don't ever want to leave. I'm in a tropic.
even caught a fish on the way. Well, half a fish. It seems that something got to it before we could bring it onto the boat. Still, it made for a delicious lunch. The volcano on Montserrat blew its lid in 1995, destroying the capital city and making most of the southern half of the island uninhabitable. An exodus then occurred, and the island is now only sparsely populated. The volcano remains active, as evident from steam and other gases visible near the summit. Now, strictly speaking, anchoring here is prohibited for safety reasons. That means going to shore is also prohibited for the same reasons. That said, a mining operation of some sort is active in this zone, and that gave us confidence that the volcano probably wasn't going to kill us on this day. We decided to go exploring. Exploring the remnants of the city was surreal. Everything was inundated by volcanic ash and rubble. VHS tapes, calendars, and hotel record books served as a reminder that time stopped here in April of 1995.
I just think it's kind of cool because it's from when it happened, but it's not an interesting calendar at all.
In fact, the area was so overgrown that we were unable to find our way back to the beach. We instead had to follow a road back. This was a tricky endeavor, as the road is trafficked by mining trucks, and we weren't exactly supposed to be there.
Can't tell.
Eventually, we sailed back to our legal anchorage where we left Tarka and spent just one more day on this beautiful, if not a little unsettled, island.